Today, I think what we are going to talk about is not something really surgical, though I am a pediatric surgeon, but it is something which is common, not very common, but it is common. But the problem is nobody knows whom to go to, nobody knows who is the correct person to treat this, and first of all, whether this can or cannot be treated. So what I am going to do now is just sort of go through what is the typical bedwetting child whose parents are given a lot of advice by people. Either they say, no, child is very small, let the child grow up, then he or she will become all right. Or the other thing is, no, the child is doing it on purpose. The child wants attention from the parents and that's why the child is going to do it. Or the child is so bad now that he may require psychiatrist help. So most of them are being referred to a psychiatrist saying that, something wrong in the mental balance. Or, they'll say, just let's wait and watch. As the child grows up, he'll grow out of it and he should be all right and don't worry and, that type of thing. Now, who is responsible for this is, some of it is our problem, means the doctors who are not adequately informed about what bedwetting is all about and why it is important to be treated and not just let alone. And the second part is sometimes the parents also. Parents, because they have the same idea in the mind, that it's too small, let us wait, let's see, we'll go to the doctor unnecessarily, he'll ask us to do treatment and it may not be required, then why do you want to do all these things? So basically what I want to do is, over the next few minutes, try and clear up some concepts about bedwetting. Now, bedwetting, first of all, is significant only after the age of 5 years. Till the age of 5 years, we do not consider it as abnormal. Only if the child continues to wet the bed at night after the age of 5 years, yes, then it is considered as abnormal. So it is called nocturnal enuresis. Nocturnal is night. Enuresis is involuntary passage of urine. Now, there are different classifications based on which the treatment may be different. So, it's not like all colds are treated with one antibiotic, one anti-congestant and one thing. No, it is not that simple. Each one has to be tailor-made based on the problems in that given child and then only we can treat it. Now, what is primary and secondary? Now, primary is a child who has been wetting the bed from before, which is normal, and continues to do so without any break or without any period of dry nights. And the secondary one is, if a child has been bedwetting, he stopped for a period of at least 6 months or more and then has restarted having wetting at night, that is secondary. Now the difference between these two is, secondary type of bedwetting, or what is known as onset bedwetting, these are the ones which may be having a psychological problem behind the restarting. So the point is, if it has started after 6 months, then think about some psychological problem, either a fight in the house, or maybe the parents have separated, or the child has been thrown into boarding school, or any of those kind of things. A psychological problem will be there only in the secondary type, not in a primary. And in primary, it is what is known as monosymptomatic. That means the only problem in the child is that the child bedwets at night. During the day, child is perfectly all right. There is no problems in passing urine. And the other, which is non-monosymptomatic or polysymptomatic, is the child has bedwetting at night. And in addition, during the day, the child may have various types of things like, urgency, incontinence, where the child also passes some urine in his underwear during the day, or he has got frequency, more than 8 to 10 times in a day he has to go and pass urine. Any of those, like lower urinary tract symptoms or dysfunctional voiding symptoms, that is non-monosymptomatic. So again, the whole thing gives a different connotation, our approach changes, the treatment may change. Now, how does it affect? It affects the child and it affects the parents. in terms of child, the self-image of the child goes down, though the child is not going to tell the parents, ki, look, my self-image is going down. Nobody says that. But you realize it from the way the child behaves, from the way the child may become more quiet. The self-esteem of the child also is gone down because they feel they are a failure. The parents also tell them, what is this, you're 5 years, 6 years old and still you are bedwetting, you're not small now. So they get a negative image about themselves and they go into a sort of a depression. They get easily teased and then therefore bullied by others. Because the others say, look, we are dry at night, you're still bedwetting, that means something is wrong with you. So they again, because they are already lost their self-image, they become more cowed down. They are easily bullied by their friends, by their cousins, whoever know about it. They cannot go for overnight stays. Now usually in 6, 7, 8 year old children, they may be going to their aunts or their grandmothers or somebody's houses to stay overnight during vacation. They dare not do it because their fear is that they might bedwet over there, they will come to know, therefore better not to go. There are overnight picnics which may be arranged by the schools, where again the child will refuse to go because they say no. Over there if I do this bedwetting and everybody will come to know and they'll start teasing me. So all these things may ultimately lead to even anxiety and depression in a child. So therefore it is very important not to neglect this and say, let's wait and watch type of a thing. Now, is treatment really required? Again, as I said, the psychological impact is amazing. You can have behavioral disorders in some children. There may be embarrassment and victimization, which is exactly what I was saying, that, you know, bullying, social problems, anxiety on part of the children. There may be isolation because they don't want to make friends because friends are going to tease them. So they say, let's take a step back. I don't want to go anywhere. And lack of self-confidence. So all these things can affect the children. Now the parents on the other end, yes, it can have an impact on the parents. They feel ashamed to discuss the bedwetting problem. And therefore they will not tell it to either their family doctor nor to anybody else. I have known at least 3 parents who had come to me with their child for some surgical problems. We treated the surgery. The child became all right. They were about to go. Means after their follow-up, they came to me and they said, there is no problem. Now he is doing well. But by the way, doc, my child still does bedwetting. I said, what do you mean by the way? Which means already in their mind, they have accepted that this is a problem, but we have to wait and watch. But since I am with a doctor, let me tell the doctor, like, by the way, he also does bedwetting. I said, no, don't do by the way thing, because this is a condition by itself. It needs to be looked into and don't ignore it. So this is an attitude. There is also required to take extra efforts in washing the mattress, the bed sheets, the clothes which are being wetted by the respective child. And then the smell of urine, especially, see, in abroad it is different, where each child may have their own bedrooms. Here it's not possible, so it may be the family sleeping in a bedroom or more than one child sharing the same bedroom with the grandmother, etc. So all these things again become a social problem and irritates the parent. Then they, as I said, the time spent is on extra homework because of the bedwetting. Again, it increases financially also, because getting all the things done again and again on a daily basis or whatever the frequency, again using more bed sheets, more washing machine, more whatever it is, all these things lead to financial and economical burden, and then they get irritated with the child and start punishing him. And that is the worst thing that you can do, because please remember, no child wants to purposely bedwet. No child in the world wants to do it on purpose. They are doing it purely out of some problem which they have. Do not think that they are purposely doing it. And that is why the parents' queries are very common, that is this treatable or what? Whom should I go to? Does this require any surgical problem which needs to be corrected? And how long will the treatment take? And or shall I just wait and watch? See, these are common things, because they are not sure and nobody knows. And this, I am telling you, not only in India. There was a survey conducted of parents in France in the year 2004 or 5. And the parents made a note saying that the doctors don't listen to us or pay attention when we tell them that our children are having bedwetting. So please listen to us. We have a problem, but the doctors choose to ignore and they say wait and watch. So therefore we wait and watch type of a thing.
This bedwetting is happening all over the world, no?
Yes. The unfortunate part of bedwetting is that whatever the statistics which we quote are not necessarily India based. Like if I say that almost 15% of children at the age of 5 years are bedwetting. That means out of every 100 children who are 5 years old, 15 of them are bedwetting at 5 years, which goes down to about 10% at the age of 7 years. So in a batch of 50 in a class, in a given classroom of 50 students, there will be at least 7 who will be bedwetting, though nobody knows about it, nobody will talk about it. So it is, again, unfortunately, we are quoting only foreign base because we have not got our own basis. I would love to have conduct a survey in school, say in Bombay. Similar one can be conducted in Pune, Nasik, anywhere, where the parents are asked that please just fill up a form. The form will be given without the name of the child to be written so that there is anonymity. We do not know which child is there. We just want to know male or female, that is boy or girl, what is the age, is there bedwetting, is it primary or secondary, are there any other symptoms, and then from that statistics we can come out with what is the actual incidence in India. It may be more than 15%, it may be less, I do not know. But unless we conduct a survey in schools and the schools, the parents and the teachers and the principal accept it and are willing to take part, there is no way we can get a true idea as to what is the incidence of bedwetting. Now the parents, again, they have loss of confidence in their parenting skill. They think they have failed in their parenting because in spite of teaching all these things, my child is still bedwetting. They have disappointment with themselves. They say, no, we are not good parents, we are bad parents. See, now it is going to be more problematic because today it's a nuclear family. There are no backups. It is only husband, wife and the children. Rarely do you have backups like grandparents where or other uncles and aunts, which was there in the past, where there was a joint family staying together, so somebody or the other was looking after the children. Here now it is many times double income. So both the parents are out. So the child may or may not be looked after either by a babysitter or in one of these creches. So again, they feel guilty that, you know, we have to work to earn and we have to send this child to a creche. They are not probably taking care. So I am failing somewhere. So this also is a bad thing. They consider inattention by the child to correct the problem, that the child is not bothered about it, which is wrong. Washing clothes, linen, it's a physical and a financial problem. They become more intolerant. Now you must have read about 2 years back, there were two incidents where in Bengal, one child who was staying in the boarding had bedwetted, and the warden of that particular hostel made her drink her own urine as a part of treatment. I don't know who gave her this idea that this is a treatment for bedwetting. But the point is, people are so unaware and so stupid sometimes that they do this. And in other case, the child was beaten up because the child had bedwetting, which is again the same thing, that no child wants to do this purposely. So therefore, punishing, scolding, beating does not make sense. And if at all, it's going to make the problem worse. Nobody has followed up these children to know what has happened after the punishment was given. Has the child really improved or has the child worsened? My feeling, 100% the child must have worsened. Not only in terms of bedwetting, but in scholastic view, in anxiety, in depression, in becoming introverted, in going away from people, going and staying alone. all these things are going to occur because we have not pinpointed nor tried to exactly find out the problem and treat it. Now, can you help a child overcome bedwetting? Of course you can. Now, how is based on if you can understand what is the problem, then you will agree with me that yes, this is something which needs to be treated, can be treated, and therefore has to be treated. So let us make it as simple as possible since I am talking to laypersons. What is the definition of bedwetting? It is involuntary emptying of the urine from the urinary bladder which stores the urine while the child is asleep, right? So therefore the three white things are urine, bladder and sleep. So what if I tell you that there are problems with each of these things which can give rise to bedwetting? So basically bedwetting is what? It is a mismatch between the amount of urine produced at night, the capacity of the bladder or the holding ability of the bladder, and arousal from sleep. Most of us, if we sleep on a full bladder, we wake up in the night because we feel uncomfortable. We get up, go to the bathroom, pass urine, come back, and we are all right. Now, if this arousal is not there, the bladder capacity is less, or the volume of urine is extra, then you can have the problem. So, what are the causes? One is problem with the urine volume. Now, ideally, if you see how many times does a child or even an adult go and pass urine during the day? About 6 times average, which is 16 hours out of 24 hours that you are awake, you go 6 times. Night, you sleep for 8 hours, which is half of 16. Now, how many times should you be going to pass urine at night? 3?
3.
Nobody does it. Nobody goes there. Now, why does that happen? Simple reason that the problem is the urine produced at night is less than half of what is produced during the day. And that is based on what is known as an antidiuretic hormone, which is preventing excessive volume of urine from being produced only at night. And therefore, it's a normal what is known as a circadian rhythm. That means it kicks off in the evening, because of which the urine volume goes down and therefore urine does not accumulate and therefore urine output becomes less. Now, if there is a problem with urine volume because of the ADH or the antidiuretic hormone being deficient, you are going to have a large volume. So even if you are perfectly normal otherwise, you are going to either get up and go and pass urine again and again, or you will pass it in bed. The other problem is with the bladder. Now, in case of bladder, there are two things which are to be looked at. One is, what is the capacity of a bladder? Ideally, in a say 8-year-old child, the normal capacity of a bladder to fill and hold urine without needing to go and pass urine is about 300 ml. Now, if the child's bladder capacity, instead of being 300 ml, is only 150 ml, what is going to happen when the child accumulates 150 ml of urine? The bladder is full and either the child has to go and pass urine or the urine will get passed on its own. So therefore, either of these things can give rise to bedwetting at night if the bladder capacity is small. The other thing is, whenever one wants to pass urine, there is a bladder muscle and there is consciousness. So when we go on pass urine in the bathroom, we first cause the bladder muscle to contract, which is called the detrusor, and simultaneously the sphincter which prevents the leakage of urine relaxes, and that's how the bladder empties. Now, this is all under voluntary control. Now, suppose I tell you that in many of the children and in adults also, the abnormal detrusor contractions occur. That means the bladder muscle suddenly contracts at any time during the day or night. What is going to happen is the sphincter is reflexly going to relax because the bladder has contracted and the child is going to pass. Now, is it the fault of the child? The child is not doing it on purpose. It is abnormal bladder contractility. And many times that is seen more in the evenings or at night rather than during the day. So the child may be perfectly all right but by day, but may be abnormal by night. Or the child may be having both, which may explain why the child is also having other symptoms like urgency, frequency during the day. So therefore, the treatment may be different in this child than a child who has got a problem with a urine volume. So these things are there. The third is with sleep. Normally, as I said, we get awakened, cause a discomfort if the bladder is full. In these children, many times they do not get aroused, they do not realize their bladder is full, and therefore they automatically pass. Characteristically, many of the parents will tell me that very difficult to wake up from sleep, very deep sleep, and they usually compare with their other children or other child, and they say, no, this one I can wake up very easily, but this very difficult to wake up, they are deep sleepers. And because they are deep sleepers, sometimes they do not realize, they don't get aroused by the feeling of discomfort, and they pass in the thing. Now these are so many problems. Now you consider, if out of these three or four what we have talked, there may be one, there may be two, or there may be all three. Now if all three are there, or even two are there, or even one is there, there is no uniform method of treating. Each one has to be specifically treated. If it is excessive urine volume, you have to treat to decrease the urine volume. If it is abnormal bladder capacity, you have to increase the bladder capacity. If it is abnormal contraction of the bladder, you have to treat to prevent abnormal contractions. And if it is sleep problems, then you have to train the child to get up, pass urine at night, etc. So therefore, I come back to the same thing, is that there is no common treatment, and not that there is no treatment. There are treatment, and therefore we have to look at it from that point of view. As I said, we'll take each one in little bit in detail. Normal urine during the day is, as I said, 6 times. At night it is less than half of the volume produced during the day. But if the urine is equal to the amount produced during the day, naturally the bladder is going to get filled up. And in some cases, there may be more urine than is normally produced. And if there is a deficiency of the antidiuretic hormone, you have to give that hormone at that time so as to get come to normal. Now in case of bladder, as I said, if the capacity is below normal, there is nothing that you and I can do except try and improve the bladder capacity with drugs. If the bladder capacity, sometimes they have found, is only abnormal at night and not during the day. This they have done sleep urodynamic studies. Now we cannot start doing urodynamic studies on each and every child who gets bedwetting, because the parents will run away. So the point is, we have to judge what is the exact problem in a given child. And as I said, the bladder muscle, if it is frequently contracting at abnormal rate, it can give rise to irritation, which can give rise to relaxation of the sphincter. And therefore, one big thing which many parents are not aware, even though I ask them, is your child constipated? No. But then when you ask, does he pass hard stool? Does he pass daily? Does he eat salads, and does he eat fruits, and does he eat vegetables? Then they start coming out with, yeah, he is not very regular. Sometimes he doesn't pass for 2 days. Sometimes he passes hard stool. See, the problem is, even a hard stool in the bladder, in the rectum, which is sitting just behind the bladder, can irritate the bladder from behind, can compress the bladder from behind and give rise to problems. And which is why they have found, in a child with constipation and bedwetting, if we treat the constipation, almost 70% of the children stop bedwetting. Because you have taken away a primary cause, which you have to ask. And not just say, is he constipated? No. He's not. Does he eat everything? Yes. When you ask details that they come out with, no, he doesn't eat this, no, he doesn't in so vegetables
main,
only.
That is also constipation is the main cause.
Is one of the main causes, yes.
Eating junk food and all these things.
That itself is a problem. Which is why I am saying that people are not aware, and which is why these lectures are important to be heard is because they should realize that these are things which are there, have been there since past, but can be treated in a proper manner if it is done systematically.
Junk food and the soft drinks, canned juices, these also
they are causing the stomach to be filled so that at the time of actual lunch and dinner they don't feel like eating. These Cheetos and all these things are a problem. Again, in sleep, I'm not going to go into details of REM and NREM, but during that sleep, a particular type of sleep, they can get no sense of fullness in certain children, and therefore they are not able to get up. And sometimes, as I said, the capacity or the irritation of the bladder may be occurring only at night, which is not present during the day. Again, we need to look after it. So besides routine investigations and going in for the treatment cannot be generalized. There is something called specific treatment based on what is the cause in that child. Now, whether it is bladder retraining, whether it is conditioning. Conditioning is a way of, you know, realizing that the bladder is full. So you make the child get up at 2 o'clock. After the child goes to bed, go and come back and sleep. And that is one method. Then there are general measures, which we talk about. Less fluid after 5 p.m. One glass of water with dinner. No liquids after dinner, no giving Complan or Horlicks at bedtime, which is a common thing given by parents. Not at least in these children. And of course, specific medications based on whatever is the problem. If there is an abnormal bladder capacity, we would give one particular drug. If there is excessive bladder contraction, we'll give another drug. Extra volume of urine, we give the antidiuretic hormone. So, but we cannot start giving this in all cases, and therefore we need to research and find out what to do or start any particular mode of therapy and have a good follow-up of these patients. Only then we will be able to help. Now, as I said, just before going to bed, the child must pass urine twice, compulsory, every day. Never, as I said, don't be angry, don't scold, don't punish the child. In fact, be supportive, reassure, praise the child for every drive night that the child can be done, and make sure the child is not constipated. So the child has to check out whether the child is or is not regularly passing stool, whether stool is normal or not, etc. And encourage him or her to work on a treatment plan which is suggested by the doctor. And take medicine, if at all is given, on a regular basis. Again, what you should not be doing is giving child fluids for a few hours before bedtime. At least for 2 to 3 hours from the before bed, stop all liquids to the child. So dinner has to be well before that. Also, try and avoid caffeine. See, caffeine is a diuretic which causes increase in urine output. So no coffee, no cocoa, no chocolates, no colas, no artificial colored drinks, none of them, because some of these can be allergic, and the allergy manifests by excessive bladder contractions. So any of these things should be avoided. Don't scold and punish. Stress makes it worse. So avoid letting your child get too tired. No excitement just before bed. So therefore, ideally, they should not be seeing CID and murder and violence just before they go to bed. Now, I have been doing this specialty clinic for the last 4 to 5 years for only bedwetting. It's for this reason. The first consultation of mine takes almost an hour because I need to go through almost 50 questions or more, which have to be answered by the parents before I come to a rough calculation as to probably in this child what could be the cause of bedwetting. And based on that, I would then analyze as to these are the probable cause or causes in this child, and therefore we need to tailor the treatment for this particular child, and then we plan the treatment. Ask for a bladder diary, which they come and follow up with us, and then we set a plan and then start the process of treatment, knowing very well that this is not an instant thing. Like if I start treatment today, don't expect the child to become dry in 10 days or 20 days. It may take months, it may take years, there may be relapses. They may have to follow up for a longer period. We may need to tweak the dose of the drugs. We may need to decrease it. We may need to taper it. We may need to stop it also. Any of these things, but it requires a prolonged period for treatment, prolonged follow-up, and only then that you will be getting results. And there have been children who are 10 years old who have been bedwetting every day, which we call 7 wet nights a week, who have come down to 0 or 1 wet night per week within 3 months. And they were happy. But the problem is, when we tell them to follow up, many of them may not follow. And if they do not follow up, then the problem is they stop medicines on their own, they take different drug dosages on their own, they don't bother to follow up, or they go to homeopathy and Ayurvedic because they think, no, these are allopathic drugs, therefore we should not be taking. And many times we give them this ADH or vasopressin, which is desmopressin, which is the drug. And they say, no, doctor, we stopped it. And I said, why did you stop it? And they said, no, you can't give for too long. No, I said, you are aware of a disease called diabetes? They said, yes. So I said, what do they give? Insulin they give. They said, yes. So I said, if the blood sugar comes to normal, do you stop giving insulin? Because the blood sugar is normal. They said, no, how can you? I said, then why did you stop desmopressin? Because the child was dry, you don't stop the desmopressin, you continue it for a period of time and then come back to us. We will start your tapering, we will gradually taper it, and then you may go without the desmopressin and yet be dry. But you cannot just on your own stop the treatment. Or they say, no, we had to go out for vacation. So I said, can you not make him pass urine twice just before bed, even on vacation? Can you not restrict the fluids just before 2 hours or 3 hours before bedtime? So the same rules which appear in your city can be followed anywhere, provided the parents and the child are both cooperative, motivated and positive inclined, that they want to stop this and they are willing to work for it. It's not going to come just about anyway. And therefore the approach of wait and watch and let us see is not going to work. Now what is going to happen if the bladder capacity is small by waiting and watching? The bladder capacity is not going to grow on its own. Nor is the irritable bladder going to become less irritable with age. Nor is the urine volume going to decrease because there is deficiency of the hormone. It's not going to auto-correct itself or something. Therefore, you need to get treated. But whether, whom to go, when to go, all this is more important that people realize. And of course, the family practitioners and the pediatricians should be made more aware so that they can send the patients to people who are selectively into this, because I have been treating bedwetting as a separate thing. So when somebody says, by the way, I have got bedwetting, I said, no, you go home and you come back with a fresh appointment for bedwetting. Then we will not discuss the hernia or whatever else we have done for your child. And that is important, that it is a problem, it has many causes, and they are all treatable. How long they will take to get treated, how long they will get before they become totally dry, is a question of time. But not taking treatment or just waiting and watching is not an option. Okay? Any questions, please ask.